collect also humongous amount of data for customers from patient monitors, the devices with the wiggly lines you see on TV in emergency rooms. All of these are businesses where Philips has a very high, high share. And in our consumer businesses, we have a history of making appliances, things that you plug into the wall and they do something for you. You can use them to brush your teeth, to extract milk, to cook foods, to prepare juices. And we see also there that technology and applications and the way consumer preferences are moving, we are generating increasing amounts of data from those devices. And what I want to explain to you today is how, and I think this is also probably what Frans did, how we look at that and how we want to bring value out of that data for our customers and for our users. I'm in a business in Philips. It's called population health, which I'll talk about later as well, specifically in an area that focuses more on the consumer self-management and disease prevention side of things. So I'm in a business that really is has one foot in healthcare and one foot in the consumer space. Wanted to start with some statistics just to describe to you the magnitude of the problem and the magnitude of the healthcare industry. Those of you who are not from the healthcare industry may read about increasing cost of healthcare. The healthcare industry is gigantic in some countries more than others. The far ahead of everyone else is the United States. It spends something like 18% of GDP on healthcare. If that was a country, it would be in the G7. It's that big. Also in Europe, healthcare spend is about 10% of GDP. In some countries like the Netherlands, it's more. It's more close to 15. And it's been going up at a rate that is unsustainable. So the industry and politics, governments have been looking for solutions to this problem, ways of slowing down the ever-increasing cost of healthcare. And one of the ways we believe to do that is to prevent the problem from occurring in the first place, or to postpone symptoms, not just to treat them, which is how the healthcare system has worked more traditionally, but actually to prevent things from happening. And this requires a lot of changes. It requires changes in the way that policies are written. It also requires changes in the way the healthcare industry is funded, and also very much in the way that incentives work, because in many countries, doctors, hospitals, pharmaceutical companies, companies like Philips make money by treating patients, right? Not really by preventing things. And we, in our business, are trying to change that and direct some of the investment also towards prevention. Only about 3% of healthcare spend goes to prevention, 97% goes to treatment. If you look at the population statistics, and these are from the WHO, you'll see that there's a lot of lifestyle disease risk in the European population. There's increasing obesity in some countries more than others. Even amongst very young children, doctors are seeing pre-diabetic children of the age of 5 or 6 or 7 these days, which is shocking if you think about it, just because of poor lifestyle. And if, as a population, we were either asked to take more responsibility for our health or we found inherent reasons to do so, we could make a dramatic change in these types of statistics and therefore also really affect the economics of the healthcare industry. And when we talk to our customers, we hear them say, increasingly hear them say things which are related to this analysis I just gave you. Hospitals are, in order to control the cost of healthcare, are increasingly being made responsible for the risk in a population. So rather than, and this is very much also a change that is happening in the United States as a result of the famous Obamacare legislation, which is saying to hospital systems, don't just focus on treating people who are ill, but actually take responsibility for, we'll fund you for looking after a population. Whether you spend that money most efficiently by treating everybody or by preventing disease or by doing things to mitigate risks, that's up to you. Your economic incentive is to essentially, you know, get the maximum amount of outcome in your population with the least amount of funding. And that means that there's a mindset change now happening amongst hospital administrators and large players in the healthcare industry who are starting to think about this in a different way. And when I say population, it's usually a geographic group of people that live around in the catchment area of a particular hospital system. And typically, it's not a single hospital in the United States. It's a group of hospitals, also involving many general practitioners in one system. Some of them are very, very large. The NHS in Europe is an example of such a system as well, that is essentially a population management, health management organization. We see care teams looking to make more use of data to be able to make decisions at the right time with the right data available. So a lot of data is generated by healthcare technology, as I told you earlier, but most of it is locked in a silo inside that particular application or inside a file that sits in the room of a doctor. Often patients see multiple doctors in the same hospital, and these doctors don't have visibility of each other's records and each other's treatment plans. That can be conflicting or certainly lead to sort of duplicative analysis and extra cost. So just unlocking data out of these silos already is a very powerful thing. And consumers, I think, are increasingly ready to take more control of their health. So healthcare, if you think about it, is a sort of a pre-industrialized industry. I'm sure some of you remember the days when you went on holiday, you used to go to a travel agency that you would say to, I'd like to go to a warm place and I have about this much available. And then they would open brochures and they would decide basically where you would go, right? They would pick a tour operator who had already picked an airline, and you would buy a package holiday. That's kind of unthinkable these days. We all use the internet to book our own flights, to investigate and research our own trips, to see reviews about our own hotels, and we make specific decisions to go to particular places ourselves. We organize this ourselves. We've been given the power to do this by deregulation, by technology, and also by commercial initiative from companies that have broken out of the old mold. Something similar has happened in finance. These days, we invest our own stock portfolios and manage, and many of us are active in managing our own pension plans. This used to be something that the bank would do for you, or somebody, you know, with a lot of education did stuff that you had no way of possibly understanding in systems that you could not use. All of this has been consumerized, if you will, and we believe that this will happen also to healthcare. Technology, legislation, the availability of data, the cost of sensors, the internet, mobile, will put more and more power into the hands of patients. And that is, we believe, a good thing. It also has inherent dangers. It could also mean that things that don't actually work make their way into consumers' hands who have false impressions on their health. So it does have to be controlled and regulated, and that's something the healthcare industry is thinking deeply about. In Philips, the way we look at this is that we'd like to turn all of these isolated modalities or products that we make, MRI scanners, CT scanners, ultrasound machines, patient monitors, toothbrushes, baby bottles, measurement devices, into nodes onto one that basically communicate onto one data set, where we are able to see longitudinal development of healthcare by combining what we learn about the same patient or the same hospital or the same procedure or the same part of the hospital or the same technology across all of the data that we collect and that our customers collect using our products. And that is a very big task, and it involves a lot of infrastructure, which I'll talk about later. And we think about this as a form of continuous health, where you really put the patient or the hospital at the center of your thinking, and not this particular treatment or the particular device that we make. But you think about it, you architect it from the perspective of the user or the customer. In population health, which is one of the businesses that plays in this continuum, we try to come up with solutions for those customers that have risk for a population. Clearly, those are insurance companies, governments, some of the accountable care organizations in the United States that I talked about who basically carry population risk. And what we do is we help them understand and analyze their population. So we use data analytics, we use consultancy services to show them within there, and they usually have very large data sets of sort of transactional information about treatments and tests, etc., that happened on their patient population. We help them analyze those data sets and identify particular segments in their population that have a high risk of developing a disease or of being in a situation where medical care is going to be needed. We try to predict essentially the need for medical care. And then we help them with programs developed internally and sometimes also with partners that address those particular risks in specific segments. And it's a portfolio of things. So you might think about a program that aims to reduce the risk of risk pregnancies for a particular strata of women who, for example, have high blood pressure. You might have a program for people with a higher risk of developing diabetes, or a program with people for people who have a high risk of developing cardiac disease, or certain types of cancer that are related to lifestyle. Or people who've been discharged from hospital after treatment and who have a high risk of having to return to hospital because they will deteriorate. And we try to use technology to prevent events and predict events so that interventions can be made before it's too late. That's essentially what population health is about. And I want to show you a few examples of how we do this. One business that we have is one called Lifeline, which is mostly active in the US, and it's a fall detection business. So you see the lady in the picture wearing a pendant, and the pendant actually has a very sophisticated set of sensors that can detect with a very high level of accuracy a fall and communicate out to an emergency response center. So we run this as a service. We have call center teams that will intervene immediately. There's a box in the home which is a bit like a very sensitive speakerphone, so we can actually talk to this old lady when she falls, for example, at 4 o'clock in the morning in her bathroom. And falling is a very critical event because it's usually the point where somebody can no longer live at home independently. And that's something we all want. We all want to grow old in the comfort of our own home. And demographics mean that there is a very large group of people who live alone in their own home. And what we try to do is, as soon as the fall happens, we try to intervene immediately and send the neighbor around, or the oldest daughter who lives around the corner. So we have a list of people that we call, and in the extreme case, we call emergency services. We know where the key is so that they can enter the house. And if we can be there in 20 minutes instead of 4 or 5 hours, that makes a world of difference. The outcomes are completely different. In the former case, usually somebody can recover. In the latter case, typically you have to go into a care home, which is not what people want. But we've seen that in that information that we collect from these sensors, we can actually start to predict events. So with a relatively high degree of accuracy, we can predict whether people are likely to be admitted to hospital in the next 30 days. And this is used by their healthcare systems to reach out, to find out what's going on, and to intervene when they still can. And this is just from essentially accelerometer data, independent, and behavior in using the service. And when you run these types of services for hundreds of thousands of people for a very long time, you build very rich data sets, and you can find very interesting conclusions in them and use those to prevent a lot of misery. Another example, which is my own business, is Personal Health Solutions, where we are working on lifestyle change coaching programs. So this is where we try to prevent chronic disease in groups where there is a very high risk of developing chronic disease. And we work with customers to identify what those groups are. Typically, it's based on things like BMI, blood work, some genetic information. And we identify groups of users who have a high risk of developing diabetes or cardiac disease, and we provide them with coaching programs to help them understand the relationship between their behavior and their health, and to help them make small changes to the way they live their lives to really reduce the risk. And even a couple of small changes to how you eat, how you move, how you sleep, how you deal with stress, it can have a very significant outcome on risk. We do this with using smartphone technology, a consumer application, in combination with devices that measure biometrics. And we do that because the devices provide highly accurate information. In case of our health watch, which is on one of the devices on the picture, it does this. It measures about 20 biometrics, 24/7. And we can see, we can immediately see the reactions to lifestyle changes, and we can immediately see the pace at which people are taking on board the coaching and adjust and personalize the experience. So this, yeah, this service is essentially a fully automated virtual coaching environment that personalizes your lifestyle recommendations entirely on the basis of your of what we measure about you in our with our devices and also through use of the application. And we see very good results. We see significant reductions in blood pressure. We see high levels of engagement, so people kind of sticking with the program and finishing it. We see significant weight loss. All of these things translate to big reductions in disease risk. There is a third business that looks at the very other end of the spectrum, the highly frail, chronically ill patients, typically with multiple chronic illnesses, where we try to move care from the hospital to the home and prevent deteriorations and readmissions. And I want to show you a video to explain how this works in practice.
I like Sun City. It's a nice community. Our grandchildren come over here once a week. We have a couple of good friends that we like very much.
One. In our age group, these are the things that are important.
When we first met, he was just a friend, nothing serious. He took me to a football game and gave me my first kiss.
Don't go overboard now.
Without communication, Ralph and I could have never survived the 64 years.
We know that the top 5% of patients in any system use a lot of resources, time, money, people, you name it. Philips and Banner are partnering to take care of the sickest of the ambulatory patients. We hope that we will be able to provide the support that they need to allow them to continue to live out their days at home.
Ralph's not very good at taking his own blood pressure, so I take his blood pressure every morning. But he gets on the scale, weighs himself.
184.4 pounds.
And then he goes to his little video. I'll learn to say tablet one of these days. At first, we were a little hesitant about all of this equipment, but as it was explained to us by people from Banner Eye Care and from Philips, we reached a point where we felt comfortable with it. Today, I would be lost without it. I'm just happy to be home with Ralph, to be able to talk to a doctor on a video, and we don't have to wait 2 or 3 days for a doctor appointment. It's fabulous. If I have an emergency, all I do is push a button. There's somebody at Banner Eye Care there for me immediately.
This is the future. It's really an amazing model of care that doesn't exist anywhere else yet. When I have a team of people augmented by a lot of Philips technology, I can catch things earlier, treat things earlier, and intervene in a way that allows me to accomplish what I set out to do as a geriatrician and then ultimately to do some good in these patients' lives.
I'm just thankful that we joined Banner Eye Care and that we have Philips equipment here. We're married 64 years. I can't say we'll have 64 more years.
We're trying.
Yeah, we're trying.
Innovation and you. Philips.
So I think you can imagine that in this type of system, the quality of life for people involved is much higher than if there's a lot of events and they have to continuously go back to hospital, which with this group of patients happens all too frequently. Also for physicians, they're able to remotely diagnose things. They're able to monitor their patients at distance. They're able to use the different people in the care team for different tasks. They're able to talk to people on video conference rather than have them come into hospital and the efficiency savings and the outcomes and the patient satisfaction from this trial are very significant. And the main objective we had here was to reduce readmissions, which in the US healthcare system is actually penalized with a penalty, disincentivized with a penalty. And there was a very significant reduction in readmissions. These are just different examples of how we use data collected from devices to empower services that use algorithms to intervene and prevent bad things from happening. And a lot of that, if you stand back from it, is actually about bringing care closer to the patient. So in our devices business, our technology development, we spend a lot of our money these days taking things out of the lab or out of the operating room and bringing them into the home or next to the patient's bed, or even bringing technology that was previously only available in hospitals into GP practices, who are also much closer to patients. So we've developed things like an ultrasound machine you can run off of an Android tablet, rather than having to go to a place where there's a very expensive big machine installed. Patches that measure biometrics 24/7 in a way where you can move around and you don't have to be tied to a patient monitor with cables. Equipment also that measures white blood cell count in people in chemotherapy, so they don't go to hospital unnecessarily to find out that they're not ready yet for the next level of treatment, but they can do this analysis at home. And many other examples of products that basically used in the interaction between the healthcare system and consumers much more closely to where people like to live their normal life. We do this with product initiatives like this, but we also do this by connecting our solutions and our devices through a common infrastructure. We call this Health Suite, digital platform in Philips, which is our own, if you will, flavor of cloud, which has the properties that a healthcare solution needs. It's highly secure. It has a lot of functionality to manage privacy. It allows us to connect devices to the cloud, so we can use them in multiple applications. We can store both personal health data, information collected by consumers about themselves, as well as clinical data, which is collected by hospitals and doctors, in standard models and ways in which that make them transportable and usable in multiple use cases and multiple solutions. And we also have in this platform the technology to do data analytics, and which is essentially about tooling to be able to run analytics on these very large data sets. That's what I wanted to tell you today. Any questions?
Thanks for this very interesting talk showing the value of data in these types of settings. So I'd like to invite the audience to ask questions. So perhaps I can start off, then you have some time to think about questions.
There's one in there.
Oh, sorry. You have to throw very far.
I can hear you, yeah.
I had a question about the elderly in the healthcare. You were saying that you use all these apps and this technology, but do you also train them in that? Because I think it's a new skill for most of the elderly using all this data, all those applications.
Yes, no, it's very true. Very true. So in the video example you saw, there actually is a tablet that we provide to people to use at home. All of the data measurements basically make their way to the doctor automatically and are used in a professional application to stratify their population and rank them in terms of whether interventions are required, etc., and send out alarms if things are looking bad. But we use the tablet to ask the people to submit some observations. You cannot measure everything. You cannot measure how well you slept, for example, at least not easily. So we also ask questions. We ask people to put in data manually. And we use that also to essentially video conference between the doctor or the nurse and the patient. And we do have to train people up. But that is a problem that's also going away, because actually smartphone adoption, even amongst the elderly, is very high in most Western European markets now, and even in Asia. So I think that's a question of time, really. But we try to, for that age group, clearly we adapt the user interface because they are not dexterity in fingers, sight, you know, mean big buttons and short words and making it simple. Yeah.
So a question that I had is, what would, in your view, be the analytical challenges? Because you spoke very much how to embed this into the life of people, bringing technology closer to people. But you want to predict certain things to happen. So are there also still challenges related, I don't know, to the size of the data, that the analysis techniques are not accurate enough? Can you tell a bit about stopping Philips?
Well, I think we have the same challenges that most companies have around finding enough talent that can do this. Luckily, we have a long history of processing signals in Philips. Even in our TV and radio days, we applied a lot of that to audio and video. So we're good at reducing signal, you know, improving signal-to-noise ratios and doing interpreting signals and compressing them and etc. But pure data analytics for us is also a new thing. And so, luckily, we have a very significant research group based here in Eindhoven, also in a few other places in Cambridge in the US and a couple of other places around the world, where we increasingly employ data and analytics experts. One specific thing to healthcare, I think, is regulation. So there is very strict regulation around the way you design your products, which also applies to algorithms. And the evidence you have to provide in order to be able to make certain claims. And that is a good thing because it prevents quacks from... I mean, there are apps, I saw this on TV last night, that claim to measure your blood pressure by pressing on your iPhone screen, which clearly is not true. Mm-hmm. Our quality and regulatory people would never allow us to put a product like that on the market. But that means we have a lot of... we have to spend a lot of time and money on collecting evidence in trials and studies, more so I think than happens in most other industries. So the bar to being able to make claims, and especially when you start to diagnose things, and that is high.
Yeah, thanks. Is that all? Yeah. So I think you can both ask questions. Yeah. You can fight on the order.
Right. So I have the following question. When you have alerts, usually there must be someone that responds to the alert. Okay. If someone doesn't respond to the alert, who is that has the responsibility?
In the case of the fall detection program, yeah. So the way it works is we have a list of people we call. So this is all, when the service is set up, this is all set up as well. So this typically is neighbors, friends, family. And we go down the list, and as soon as we, if we cannot find, so first of all, we try to talk to the person in the house through the voice box. So assuming we see that there is a problem, or we don't get a response, in which case we also assume there's a problem, we start calling people on the list day or night. And if they cannot be there or they don't pick up, then eventually we call an ambulance.
Last question.
Well, two quick questions then. First one is connected to the business model. Do you plan to push a lot the device side, or you rather plan to push on the services? Who is going to buy them? Is it the people themselves, the government, the insurances, whatever? And second one, about the data. Do you plan to keep all this data for the use of Philips, or at a certain point, like for instance Google is doing, just to talk about not a big data company, at a certain point say, well, we have too much, or we have enough knowledge about them, so please guys, do something with it, or possibly help us, because we don't have enough talent in-house to do applications, whatever.
Yeah, so those two questions could easily each fill a 30-minute presentation on them in themselves, but I think the question to your business model, I think generically consumers don't like paying for services, so it's easier to sell devices. Services, we in our mind, can be bundled with a device. In business to business, it's actually the other way around, because the economics kind of typically go against investments and are more for usage-based or results-based outcomes-based fees. So they are, I think, business models are trending more towards subscription or service-based models, let's say, with equipment being bundled into that. As to your question about data exclusivity, I think hidden in that is the privacy question, which I was expecting somebody to ask. it's not our data. We don't you know, spend all of our time falling over it. We tend to we think of it as data belonging to the user or belonging to the hospital. And if we want to use it for a purpose, we will always ask their permission and explain to them why this is good for them. Of course, there's ways of anonymizing or de-identifying data in some cases. And we use a lot of this data also in collaborations with other companies or collaborations with research organizations or universities. And we also use our software and our equipment to set up collaborations with hospitals or universities to collect more data and come up with specific results. It's not, we're really not like Google in the sense that we don't give stuff away for free in order to collect a profile on you so that we can advertise. We're really, we only use it to make lives better. And primarily for the purpose for which we collect it. Yeah.
I think that was a very nice closing sentence. I think we need to stop, right, because otherwise we are delaying the program. Let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.
So the second talk in this slot continues on healthcare. So the title of the talk is Smart Data Analysis for Better Healthcare. And the talk will be given by Philipp Daumke. He is the CEO of Averbis, if I pronounce it correctly. It's a company that is one of the things it works on is tax analysis. In Philip's CV, I also saw that he worked in a hospital in Brisbane, which I find very interesting because I've been a part-time professor there for 15 years.
Okay.
So I'm curious to hear what you have to tell.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I want to bring you...
Welcome in.
Thanks a lot. I want to bring you back to the hospitals and share some experience how to leverage data really from the hospital. My background is actually I'm a medical doctor, but I never wanted to work as a doctor. I did 1 year in Australia, part of it in Brisbane. And then I went into informatics and finally end up in medical informatics, and that started the story about the company. We are based in Germany. We are a text analytics company, so we work in use cases where there's unstructured data. And our primary goal is basically to automate cognitive processes. There are so many processes in different areas where people still do manual routine jobs, intellectual processes, and we want to automate these things. We do not only work in healthcare, so about half of our business is life science, healthcare, and pharma. We recently also started to work a lot on patents. Patent is also like 50 pages of PDF documents. But we also work for other industries such as automotive, BMW. We do a bit of social media analytics, work for libraries. So it's a bit of a mix. Our product is named Information Discovery. That's basically a platform, and specifically to healthcare, it allows us to analyze heterogeneous data within hospitals for improved patient identification and cohorting. You have patients on the one hand, we do the analysis of the records of the patients, and then we want to identify certain patients, patient subgroups, patient cohorts. Why are we doing this? There are endless opportunities or endless use cases where patient identification is the basis. Decision support. We want to support doctors in making the right diagnosis, for example. I speak about a project later on which is on rare diseases where it is difficult to pose a diagnosis even on a doctor, for a doctor. We do treatment support. We recently had a project where we the guidelines for defibrillators have changed, and what the hospitals needed to do, or what they should do, is checking all the patients whether they would need a defibrillator. Problem is, they don't have access to their own data. It's just not possible to identify the patients that need a defibrillator. Coding and billing is currently still a highly manual job. So doctors in Germany, they are doctors or they are billing nurses that go through the healthcare data, through the routine data, and then manually sign what could be, or manually find out what could be coded, what could be billed for this patient on the use case. A lot of course on research, we want to identify patient subgroups and compare them to each other. And the same goes in the collaboration between healthcare and pharma. Pharma are interested in identifying patients in hospital for feasibility studies and for patient recruitment services. I speak about these use cases a little bit later. This one is still the reality. So this one highlights all the problems that we have. Healthcare is, due to limited budget, I would say, behind what could be possible, even though many hospitals nowadays have digital hospital information system, it's still a huge problem to know where the data is and to get out the data. So when we start projects with within hospitals and we ask for data, it's a normal thing that you get patient records on a USB stick for a server, to put it in your private laptop. It's often not possible. They usually not have a master patient record system. They usually do not have the one place where all the patient data is stored. And that makes healthcare analytics project quite difficult. It's all about unstructured data. This one is a cardiology report in English. This one is a German radiology report. And there's an advent of voice recognition system that also featuring unstructured data. And about 80% of patient data that is available is in unstructured form. Signs, symptoms, diseases, even drugs are usually only written somewhere in a free text form. Radiology report, pathology reports, nurses' notes, all this stuff is available only in unstructured form. Fortunately, big data technologies can also be applied to healthcare. This one is an overview of the German IT Trade Association, and I just highlight a few technologies that we are working with. Search and discovery, so just identifying patients by using a search engine would be helpful for them. Usually hospitals don't have it. Then terminologies, text mining, text semantics, making predictions. Doctors are not IT experts, are not data scientists. They would need easy dashboards to understand what is in their data. And I put some, I put the machine learning also in how do you say that in English? Strichlinie. You know what I mean. Because the problem with machine learning in healthcare is that you sometimes don't have enough data to do machine learning. You are not allowed to share data between the hospitals. You are not allowed to train a model in one hospital and bring it to the other. So it makes it really difficult to apply state-of-the-art machine learning that you know from Amazon and all the Googles and so on to apply that in healthcare. It's not that easy. The following, I want to speak about the main technologies that we are working with, which is terminologies and semantics, text mining, prediction, and search. Terminologies, fortunately in healthcare, there are a lot of terminologies available. We have ICD-10 for diseases, we have SNOMED for almost everything. We have a huge meta terminology called UMLS. So we have a rich abundance of terminology in healthcare, which is good on the one hand. And we also need it. If you look for patients to put into a certain risk group or to make a treatment support, you need to identify them. And you are looking at a high recall of the results, a high completeness of the results. If you look in Google, you search something, usually the first entry is what you are after. You're not looking through all the lists. There's actually a choke, data privacy choke. There's no better thing to, how do you say that, to protect data than putting it on the second page in Google. Nobody would look at the second page in Google. In healthcare, you want to identify all patients that suffer from lung metastasis, for example. And I made a small study on a sample data set where we identified over hundreds of different variations how lung metastasis could be expressed. So you need a lot of terminologies and semantics to really identify terminology patients with a high recall, with a high completeness. UMLS, as I mentioned, is a meta terminology that covers 100 different vocabularies. As you can see here, most of the information is stored in English. And that's another one. Maybe we don't have English as an official language anymore soon in the European Union. So as you can see, there's a lot of work to be done in the other European languages to really cover the healthcare semantic space, the knowledge space sufficiently. Text mining, as I said, this one is a German discharge summary where we want to identify diagnoses. Negation detection is something that is special for healthcare. A doctor tends to negate everything. So I have no edema, no insufficiency, no drugs taken, no alcohol. So a lot of negations. Lab values, you want to interpret the lab values. You want to know, you do not want to know that the patient got leukocytes, but you want to interpret the value, and the same for drugs. In drugs, you have the issue that there's a lot of brand names and a lot of ingredients, where you also have a lot of semantics in there. Also, de-identification is a text mining task. When you speak about the cloud, the Philipp cloud was an example, how to put data into a cloud in a data privacy compliant manner. And one part of this picture is there also that you need to de-identify free text. You have to remove the name and the numbers and the dates and all that kind of stuff. And then you can divide between the personal information and the health information, and you can then put health-related information in the cloud without having the full name of the patient in the data. So that's also a text mining task, actually. I was mentioning machine learning and prediction. I think most of you know how it works, but basically what you need is a lot of data and a lot of results, so to say. So you need the outcome. In healthcare, for example, you need training data. You have a diagnosis on the one hand, you have a lot of patients that suffer from the diagnosis, and you have another lot of patients that don't suffer from the diagnosis. So if you have this already available, then you can train a model, and then the machine would make predictions based on this training data. And as I said, this is not as easy as in other domains in healthcare, because you're not allowed to share data across the hospitals, and machine learning within one hospital is one hospital. There's just sometimes not enough data to train really models. There is a recent hype about machine learning regarding deep learning. There was AlphaGo in the press a few months ago, who won the Go game against Lee Sedol. And they recently also announced that the next big thing is health. IBM Watson actually did the same. They also won Jeopardy, and then they announced that healthcare will be the next big thing. So far, it's not a big thing for them yet, but who will know? I'm interested. There was a press release that they were able to access 1.2 million patient records in the UK. That's cool. I don't know how they did it. And in the UK, it's a bit easier. In Germany, I am not aware of anything that would allow to share millions of patient records outside the hospital. So I'm interested how they do it really practically, whether they get the data in their, on their premises. We use it in a few use cases, for example, the identification of rare disease patients, which I'll explain in a minute, or the coding and billing of surgery reports. So if you have, for example, appendectomy, it's easier to train a model where you put all the patients that had an appendectomy in the past, and then if there's a new patient, the model just tells you, okay, this is a new candidate for having an appendectomy. That's really where we apply machine learning and not use simple rules anymore for identification of coding and billing codes. And finally, the search. As I said, it would be very helpful for doctors to have a Google-like search engine just to query for patients, to have a possibility to identify some patients for according to certain criteria such as symptoms, lab values, drugs. Who was the patient that I had 2 weeks ago who had a headache and was 64 years old or something like this? I don't remember the name. There are endless use cases about search. We installed one in a hospital, and the main use case after a while was to identify patients that were similar to the patient they currently have and to copy and paste the discharge summary. So they don't have to write it again anymore. They just replace the name, just a simple one. But there are many use cases where this also would be helpful. But this is normally not in place, not in a quality that doctors would allow them to use. So we had the lung metastasis example. You do not want, if you enter lung metastasis, you do not want to miss the 100 different variations that are there, but it must have a high quality in terms also of completeness. Okay, coming to the use cases. There are three use cases that we are currently focusing in healthcare. So as I said, the information discovery gives us the basis to do patient identification in hospitals. The first use case we support is diagnosis support for rare disease. So every doctor is able to identify a cold or a broken arm or something like this. You can do an X-ray, that's an easy task. But for rare diseases, it's quite difficult. If you only have 100 people in Europe that have this disease, no doctor ever sees them. Rare diseases, if you put all of them together, there are about 7,000 rare diseases currently known in the world, and there are about 350 million people worldwide suffering from rare diseases. And it takes an average about 7.6 years to put the diagnose on a patient. That also means that some patients are diagnosed early, after the first or second visit, within half a year, and there are many patients that don't get a definite diagnosis in their life. Problem is, many of these diseases worsen over time, and good thing is there are therapies more and more available for these rare diseases. And the sooner you can identify patients suffering from these rare diseases, the better is the patient outcome and the patient life. We had a project in the three phases with seven hospitals in Germany and university hospitals. In a proof of concept phase, we were able to identify four patients out of a 100,000 patient record data set. So that's okay. As I said, it's a rare disease, so four out of 100,000 is quite a good thing. And then now we are in a phase one where we deployed our software at these centers, and there's still no outcome. There are currently a lot of patients re-invited after they were identified, and we currently wait for the outcome of the genetic tests. What you see here is the timeline, which really is heavy. So technically spoken, it would be a task within days or so. You have the tool already available. If you have the data, you put it in, you optimize, you do everything, you have everything in hand. After a few days, you have the people. In healthcare, it takes 3 years. It's about data privacy, it's about regulation. It's about the different stakeholders in hospitals, so that really is for data miner, it's a bit of pain. Second use case, patient recruitment. Only 7% of clinical trials in the US recruit on time. About 50% of US clinical trials fail to recruit the number of patients they need to. When a study starts, the patent or the drug is already patented. If there's a delay in the study, you lose days on your patent. If it's a blockbuster and you earn billions of dollars per year, you lose up to $8 million per day through each day that is where you have a delayed clinical trial, so to say. Of course, that's only valid for the blockbusters. Here, a few more facts about this one. The costs of clinical trial explode They are usually purely designed because the problem is that the people who design the clinical trial in the pharma companies don't have the knowledge about the patient populations. They don't have access to the data, so they really have a problem to say, I need the patients between 18 and 64, male, diabetes, and maybe depressive symptoms, or something like this. And the numbers of patients, as I said, is going down. And this is really a big problem for pharma companies during the drug manufacturing process. This one is a typical clinical study. So you start with basic research, then you have different study types. You go to market, and there's increasingly more post-market studies. It's also an interesting one. Phase three usually has something like 10,000 patients in the study size. And if you have a side effect, which is not that frequent, maybe one out of 10,000, but the side effect is death, you die from that drug, but only one in 10,000 people die, then a phase three study is not enough. You need more patients in your study. You need a study on hundreds of thousands of livings or million of livings. And there you need access to the data. There's no chance currently to get access to patient records who took drugs on a large scale over a country or across countries. What we can support is the... Yep. Heading through, so we help to identify the patients and to set up, these are currently activities around to set up pharma and clinical networks where pharma get access to different clinical networks. I skip the third one, coding and billing, but I still want to have a look on the lessons learned. That's important for me to tell. First thing, of course, is data quality. Hospitals even don't know themselves where the data is. There's no single person in the hospital that knows where all the data is. Big thing is data privacy. In healthcare, it's really, really difficult to develop data-driven tools because we as data researchers are not allowed to see the data. So there's also always an acrisonist job. I'm not allowed to go into a hospital and see on the results of my product. It's really difficult. And the third one is budget. Hospitals, there's a highly gap between the expectations in healthcare, and healthcare is the next big thing, and the budget that is available for hospitals to invest in this technology. My summary, not data analytics harms the patient, but data protection. I want to get also into the discussion whether data protection is good or bad for a patient. Thank you very much for your attention.
Let's thank Philipp indeed, and I will allow one quick question, but we are running a bit behind schedule, so I realize that the last sentence could trigger, but it could also cost our lunch. That's what I'm concerned about.
I was hoping that no data privacy protector is here. In the healthcare community, I'm a bit shy.
Yes, hello. That's a question, data protection.
Yep.
Do you think that the new GDPR, General Data Protection Regulation, that will allow you to obtain informed consent on data usage from your patient will allow you to have much more data and train your machine learning?
Yeah, the problem is, I believe in the informed consent. The problem is that hospitals usually don't have it yet. So what they need is, you need the 20th, if you go to a hospital, you get 10 pages to sign. You need an 11th page where it states, I agree to share my data for research. This one is not established yet. So the problem with that is if we need that, we can throw away the patient records we currently have because we are not allowed to use them. So it's a good thing for the future, but it will not help us too much within the next 10 years because it needs time to get the processes in place and then to set up a lot of data sets where we have the informed consent.
Thank you. Let's thank Philipp again.
Thank you very much.
And we move on to the next speaker. The next talk will be given by Luc Vervenne. He is the CEO of Synergetics. This is a company that is concerned about personal data management. And of course, health-related things are a form of very personal data. He has been involved in several EU projects in this space, and I'm quite sure he will talk about these. The floor is yours, Luc. And let's welcome him.
Thank you. So, continuing the last talk about privacy, we take things from a different angle, from personal data and the ownership, or at least the access, usage, and delete rights of personal data by the individual. And so we have been working with a number of hospitals that form a kind of an ecosystem. And the idea is, let's put all the personal data, patient data, in the cloud, and let health providers with the proper authorization use that data. And so you could consider that as a kind of life management system. And it keeps the data with the user, and so the user can choose health providers according to his life and health. Okay, so this is clearly about the European data privacy regulation, which we consider as an invitation to rebalance the value exchange network between organizations and individuals. So far, you saw organizations quite interested in data and setting up clouds to work with the data. But the problem is that personal data should remain personal and should be able to be shared with different providers. And so what we do is we kind of make a distinction between data and services. So if you just look at data and organize data in a region or a health community, then all these providers can make use of it insofar they are interested. So to a certain extent, we are starting to industrialize personal data. We're really looking at personal data, which is the value of which is about 1 trillion in Europe. And we need a different approach to service all these companies that need personal data. So let's look at what organizations are using it for data and insight sharing, obviously. It's more and more domain dependent, independent, and cross-domain. So they want to have not just the health data, but maybe also your social data. It's both by data transactions analytics, which are two different things, and you should be able to serve them from the same database, so to speak. And there's a number of conflicts. So the new integrated care talks about single patient view and everybody sharing that patient view. But at the same time, you also need to kind of European big data analytics and get insights out of it. So one, you have a community. The other one is cannot get big enough, so to speak, for analytics. The same with the GPR fines. They need to be assured that you don't get them. It's about 5% of your annual income. And at the same time, you want to build relationship with patients. So a lot of conflicting interests trying to get that right. And don't forget that Europe is 99% SMEs. It's not just big companies that are doing big data. 99% are SMEs, meaning companies below 250 people. The individuals are becoming active stakeholders. They're no longer immune patients, but they are actively, even if they're healthy, they're actively involved with health. And they are willing to share their data and their analytics if it is trusted. So there's no tendency to not share data. They are willing to share data if it is trusted. Trusted also means, and patient centricity means, that you talk about your community. This is the individual, he has a certain distance where his hospital and his GP lives and so forth. So he talks about that community and he's willing to share within that community. With the GDPR regulation, he has access, usage, and delete rights. So these are his rights to share and to give access to third parties. It's probably time that we look differently at identity. Today, you log in and they ask you a lot of information.
a lot of the time, the identity information is not needed. It could be well handled by pseudonyms and then go from there. And there's this sentence that identity disclosure is a prerogative of the user. It's the individual that says, OK, you're asking for my name now. Now I can give it to you. But it's not by default for starters. So we need to think differently about social security numbers that are being spread widely over the net. And again, the user wants choice. He wants to put his data with a certain specific personal data service provider. And he wants it automated. So it needs to be policy driven. So he's not bothered all the time of making decisions about his data. And of course, he's a consumer. He doesn't want worries and he wants some benefits from it. So what can we do with industrializing personal data? Is that we create a new level playing field of personal data across the board. Regardless of any provider or any big company, we organize personal data in a regional way or in a domain-specific way. And so all companies can then start working on that data, if authorized, on a similar level. So that is not happening today. So it's every company trying to imagine their own solution. We also need to try to make the GDPR into a business opportunity. There are plenty of opportunities for organizations and individuals, if you do it right, to work with personal data and to actually exploit transactions and analytics by doing this. And again, consumers need to become more active stakeholders. They are now no longer just consuming. They are actually active stakeholders in their healthcare. And of course, on top of that, the service level is where all the app economy starts to blossom. And we're talking about 1 trillion euro in Europe. So it's an important business by itself. So let's see what has been done so far. Organizations today keep personal data, health data for the moment. There is the notion of a personal data store where you put everything closer to the individual. That is not always the best solution for organizations. So there is something called Kantara UMA, user managed access, where the authorization is with the user, but the data still remains with the organization. And let's see to the control and exploitations both from users and organizations. And you see that they are different according to the setting. We are focusing on the next thing maybe, which is a personal data ecosystem, where a certain community of users and providers works together by putting both personal data and its analytics in the cloud, where the sharing is pre-agreed, and where it's still possible to have personal data with organizations or with users. But there is a very strict control, an end-to-end trust assurance on how that data is settled. And this is automated as much as possible. So that's what we call a personal data middleware utility. It's a new layer on top of the internet that takes care of trust, security, and privacy of the internet. And it's backed by a techno-legal contractual framework. There's a bunch of technology in there. There is the new legal framework. And every transaction, every session actually leads to a contract. So that's the rest of my talk is about this angle. So we will talk quickly about this utility, how it is organized from a database perspective. We believe in a democratization of analytics. Not all analytics is very high level. Some is bread and butter, and we need doctors and patients to make use of it. You want, of course, in healthcare that the answers you get from these cloud installs, that they are true and verifiable. So we need measures to assure that. And of course, such a system, such an ecosystem, needs a certain type of governance which is typically separation of concern. So the various entities that work in there have their own tasks. Okay, so we have all kinds of personal data, and typically there's data by me that I can fill in, that I completely master as an individual. And of course, in health, there's lots of data about me from doctors and hospitals and so forth. And it can be from many sizes, not just healthcare. Retail is another case, and so forth. And it could be files, it could be Internet of Anything, Internet of Things, but also context information. So context and data provide more meaning. So that is sent to the cloud, and we're using a big data system where the privacy and the secureness of the data for that individual is secured within that big data system. More on that in a minute. And then you have both analytics and transactions that can work on top of it, which end up with end providers. So we are not doing anything with services. We are just doing end-to-end trust assurance and data storage as a kind of utility service to link with health providers. So you can do that over the web with through a front channel. A lot also goes on the back channel using APIs and web services. And there is this data utility instance that that monitors and matches that everything is working okay. And we do that by using so-called connectors. Connectors to the data sources, connectors to the data stores, and connectors to any application. And that allows you a fine-grained, secure, privacy-enabled structure. So let's do it again. We have a number of these personal data stores. They are put in a NoSQL database, which runs on top of Hadoop. These are managed by so-called XAML policies. On top of that, there is different interfaces and services, because one set of data might be used in different ways for different services. And on top of that, you have the trust, security, authentication, auditing policies that manage that data before it goes out and can service to any app that is sending that. The apps can get the data, do something with it, and if more data is generated, they put it back into the cloud. And again, we do the same for analytics. Again, this is policy driven, and as such, this provides a kind of infrastructure with which healthcare providers can work. So this is set up in so-called ecosystems, combinations of organizations and individuals, including identity providers, attribute providers, service providers. And they can be organized in different ways. They can interlink from one network to another. So in Europe, 500 million people, you can guess that a couple of hundred of these ecosystems, mostly regional, some topical, can exist. Let's look at how this works in practice. So the user logs in with an identity provider. There's multiple identity providers. They just do the identification, and then they turn your identity into a pseudonym. That's a fully pairwise, persistent pseudonym, which means it's a different pseudonym for every provider. So providers cannot correlate their pseudonym tokens. Each one gets his own set for every user. Then he can go into a website, and then he orders a service, and then web services are called. And you see all these red dots are the so-called connectors. And when they get a message, they can respond to it, and the resulting of it goes into the audit bus. So that is a kind of result of what happens with that data. And there's two elements on that. One, it's kind of stored in the cloud, kind of database for any legal action, but it's also sent to the user. So the user can see who's asking for my data, even behind the portal any web service that is called, for which he has today no clue, he can now have insight and have transparency about it. We also have this kind of online compliance tester, which is testing these red bots and see what comes back. And if something goes wrong, there's either a technical mistake or there's some malignant behavior and some action can be taken. So these boxes, these connectors, lead to the fact that we have a four-way authorization protocol. So you can attach your pledges to honor obligations. You can compare your pledges to required obligations. We use the notion of sticky policies. If you get a payload data, the policy sticks on top of it, and it flows over the net till the endpoint. And so that is what happens in point three. And in point four, here you comply your obligations and record them for future use. So at all these points, checks are made to make sure that everything is okay. It gets a bit more complex in doing that. We won't go too much in detail, but the nice thing is that we can hide this behind a graphical interface using an open source Apache NiFi, where you can, in a graphical interface, massage these connectors into a network that works for you. Important is that the user gets a real-time insight on what happens with his data, even deep in web services. So in his browser or in his mobile, there is an AngularJS object that signals into an alteration of Apache HTTP, which allows him to see exactly what happens in the network. And this is kind of a something in your browser that you can open and you see in real time all the logs coming in on what happens within the data. Again, here you see that the user can see in his front end, in his front channel, or there's an application, but then can check what web services are called in that application. So he looks behind the portal into applications, and he can see through the audit bus and the privacy hub directly what happens. So this is relatively new. I don't know anybody else doing that. All that is using SAML technology. The PDS, which is a combination of personal data store, is actually quite complex by itself. It's not just a database with data. You have data by me, data about me. There's metadata, there's pointers to other places, there is actual data. You have a persona selector, you have your four-point authorization, you have all the access points and services to reach that data. So it can go quite complex, but it is built on a very scalable NoSQL, so it's quite scalable for, if needed, millions of people. All that is backed by a number of protocols. You have two versions of protocols. In the 2000 till 2012, we had SAML, IDSF. Now we have more web-oriented OpenID Connect and UMA. And they have different characteristics, but they share the same end-to-end trust assurance paradigm. And you can see that they do things differently. But we can link one to the other. So I need to heat up a bit. So these are the, let's say, the result of this system. The point is that we can talk from one protocol to another. So if you speak SAML on the one end, it can speak OpenID Connect on the other. So we can translate these protocols. Okay, I will skip this part. This is the XAML implementation. We had actually a plugin, a XAML plugin built into our Accumulo database, which makes it much more flexible to use the policy. So policy usually is yes or no. It works or it doesn't. But here we can influence through contextual measures how that is used. And so the policies become more lifelike and become more living for the user. Let me squeeze through it. So we just finished a project with LT Innovate, which is the language technology European association. And so the idea is that in democratization of analytics, we want everyday analytics to become very, very available and very ready. And so we built a portal for them where they ask their members to put all their algorithms together as APIs. And this is now sitting next to the PDS as a way to do natural language translation and machine translation and to help data, of which 60% today is non-structured, like the previous partner was already mentioning. We also need to protect against ourselves. So we cannot touch the data. So even if we are a trust operator managing that system, we're not supposed to get to the data. And so we need security against the server, and we need to make sure that verifiable responses come out of the personal data store. So what show you how it works. So this is the database system. There is this end-to-end trust assurance on top of it, and then there's all kinds of measures where we help secure the data. So the two top layers there are not particularly secure. So let's see how we can do that. We use end-to-end signatures and verifiable results. Okay. Okay, good.
So perhaps you would like to show a concluding slide?
Yes, I'll it will take some time. So let's stop like that. Okay.
Okay, I think let's thank Luc. I'm very sorry, but we are running like already 10 minutes behind schedule. So I think okay. We really need to go to the last speaker to have enough time to have lunch. So let's thank Luc again. And
yep. Thanks.
So the last talk in the session. So it's very good that people have a lot to tell. That's very nice. But on the other hand, it makes my role as a chair a bit difficult. So the last talk will be given by Olaf Lodbrok. He is the managing director of healthcare health analytics in Elsevier. And while walking into this room, I was talking with him, what is Elsevier doing with data analytics? Are they just printing journals? But he's going to explain that to us. So let's welcome him.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Can I ask for a quick show of hands? Who of you actually is in healthcare? Not bad, maybe 25%. And who of you has enough healthcare data? Is there? There's one person. I need actually to get to know you. So I promised Will that I'd explain what Elsevier does about or with healthcare data. We are, of course, very well known. We're the world's largest scientific medical technical publisher. We no longer print journals. It's all electronic these days. But what is less well known is that our sister company within RELX is a huge big data company with $1 billion of revenues. They don't actually know between 2 and 5 petabytes of data at their disposal. They have their own supercomputer, HPCC, which is a competitor of Hadoop. And they have 150 million patients' data sets in the US, with all the caveats that come with US patient data. We actually also have access to 6 million patient data sets in Germany, quite comprehensive. And we do analytics with that. What you see here is a medical graph. We do machine learning on the 6 million, and we can predict with high accuracy what patients will have. And for all medical conditions at the three-digit ICD code. Yeah. So we had heard today about the lady that is at risk of falling. We can predict that from the medical history. To my surprise, we can somewhat predict whether an acute appendicitis is going to happen. Yeah, the quality is not quite good, but there is evidence there. And of course, many other diseases. Yeah. So why is Elsevier into this? Why are we interested? We currently provide journals and books to clinicians. We train their neural network in the course of their university studies and in the course of their lifetime. And with precision medicine, that will not be enough. The information explosion will require that physicians receive patient-specific advisories at the point of care when they need it. That is precision medicine. So there are a lot of things going on in precision medicine, too much of a busy slide. There's genetics, there's information explosion, there is patient data availability. 76% of US hospitals now use a basic EMR and collect structured data. And Philipp has said there's still a lot of information in unstructured data. Patients are donating their data for research. And there is machine learning and biosensors. So huge explosion of data that we would want to make more usable for clinicians. What is the biggest problem? And I've asked you that. What is the biggest problem that researchers quote when we ask them? Yeah. In healthcare, it's about data. This is the biggest problem. All the other businesses are so much ahead of us in machine learning, artificial intelligence, et cetera, than in healthcare, because patients have a very understandable and required regulation around the privacy of their very personal healthcare data. And I don't want to see my healthcare data in the web, and neither do you, and neither does anywhere else. The converse is no one gets healthcare data at this point. It's extremely hard to get. So having 6 million patients is something of a feat. Yeah? But that is the hurdle to overcome in healthcare. So I have the luxury of being the last presenter today, and a lot of this actually was said before. This is my mental map of where the data analytics in healthcare is going. You see on the left-hand side what Philip mentioned, text mining electronic health records, getting data from biosensors, the same as with the Philips case, getting data from biosensors, et cetera. Philips also does image analytics, et cetera, et cetera. And all of this column, as it were, is about getting patient individual data into an interpretable format. We call it a patient summary, yeah? To have all that information well summarized on one patient. On the right-hand side, what you have here is natural language processing, extraction of information from the wealth of publications that we as Elsevier have, taking all that knowledge and making it usable in terms of treatment advisories, yeah, machine interpretable, not go and read the book, or go and read the article, or here are 300 articles that in total summarize what might be wrong. And then you have the glue in the middle, data repositories, machine learning, processing, big data. Huge amounts of data will be needed for precision medicine. Yeah? What comes out of this is two things. We call them in silico trials. where you run natural experiments, not clinical trials where you change something for the patient, but natural experiments where you use all that data exhaust to run analytics on what worked, what didn't, et cetera, et cetera. And of course, these will feed into the advisories, et cetera. So if you have those three things, you can better treat patients. You identify what their problem is, and this has the medical graph perhaps in it with risk modeling. You search for a mapping between the problem and you have a solution. So that's where we would like to be clearly. But there's a problem still. It's the healthcare data problem. And fortunately, there's a panacea. So Luke had the perfect panacea, and patient consent is the perfect panacea for this. We will need to collect patient consent. There's actually no way around it. Now, all the other industries are using exhaust data from different businesses to drive innovation in other businesses, et cetera. This won't work in healthcare. Yeah? It's not just the new data regulation, the new EU data regulation. The same is true in the US with HIPAA, et cetera, because patients are concerned, quite rightly, about the privacy of their data. However, and Philip mentioned this in an aside, patients will donate their data if you can assure them of the privacy, that you have de-identified the data, that you are using it for legitimate terms. We're not going to sell the data so that your insurance provider can up your premium. Yeah. We're not trying to sell you a retirement home place. What we're trying to do is to improve your condition and improve medicine as a whole. So this is the core, this is, as it were, the ethical underpinning of this, where we would see ourselves very different from Google, for example. Yeah. And that consent needs, and we've been in this, it needs trust. It needs a trust center. It needs a separation of the consent, which is patient identifiable, from the non-identifiable. Yeah. So this is beginning to be a lot of effort. If you look at Luke's system, a lot of effort to maintain this, right? You need governance. You need a governance structure. You will need to get broad consent, but still someone will have to decide, with that broad consent, is this a study that is ethically worth doing? Who provides the oversight over companies or organizations doing it? You need a governance structure. And then you need a number of things that are very difficult, but are already an order of magnitude less difficult than these problems. Yeah? This is the panacea. So getting patient consent, putting together a community of science, almost a cooperative that begins to collect patient data and to make it available for research. Yeah. So coming back to what we do as Elsevier, at Elsevier, we organize communities of science, typically around journals. Today, we're beginning to see these communities of science be organized around the data. One renowned researcher in London recently told me he is only interested, it hurts somewhat, he is only interested in the journal article as a marketing flyer for the underlying data. I thought that quite hurt, being from Elsevier, but of course he's right. He doesn't want the summary, he wants to understand the processes, the data, come to his own conclusions, etc. Yeah. So, I think technologically, ethically, legally, we are now in a position to do this, but there is still that huge investment, huge implementation problem to overcome. It's not simple. In that sense, I would be interested, so I'm sort of on a fact-finding mission, I'm interested in healthcare. I'm interested in the communities of science and healthcare and who would be interested to support this. Yeah. Thank you for your time. I'm actually down to 0 minutes just now.
There's a question there.
Hello. What do you think about the blue button and initiative in your case, which is, you know, interoperability and the ability to transfer medical data between operators?
It doesn't solve the research problem, to my knowledge. It solves the clinical decision support problem. Yeah, if you're interested at the point of care of getting an advisory or of getting in more patient data, that solves your problem. But that is under a different consent model, because you as a provider or physician already have consent to see the data. Yeah? You can't, to my knowledge, you cannot use this simply to collect data. You can use it to treat a single patient better, which is already great. Yeah. If you yell, I can hear you probably.
My question is regarding your business case on the healthcare data. So as far as I understood, Elsevier was more on the site, on the publication and on the research, and now you presented that you have a lot of healthcare data also available. So who's your target? Do you plan to provide products to doctors within the hospitals, or will it be services that are available on the web, or do you want to create your own results that you publish yourself in journals? What is the strategy?
The latter two. We would like to provide really precise clinical precision support to physicians at the point of care. Could be primary care, could be hospitals. Yeah. And of course, we are starting also to publish on this, and we do. We do about 50 healthcare studies every year on this data that we use within the German healthcare system to improve care. Yeah.
Then perhaps I may ask the last question. So you mentioned that the article becomes, or somebody mentioned that the article becomes the flyer for the actual data set. So is Elsevier trying to give more, let's say, standing to data sets? So for example, here the three technical universities together have a data center that where you can put data, it gets a DOI, and we hope that people refer to this DOI constantly so that gets credit. Can you tell a bit about the policy?
We support that totally. So you can now publish data sets with Elsevier, get that long-term archiving, get public access to that data, etc. Yes. Again, it is getting more and more important for research, not just to read. So there was a Bayer was unable to replicate, I forget, 60% of the studies that were done. So we think it is very important to make that data available in depth. And yes, we support that. Incidentally, we also support publishing the methods and programs. And if you think about it, data collection and the supporting data processing science have so far been undervalued in publications. You don't get really the impact that you would need. By publishing in these journals, by making your data publicly available, you contribute to your own, as it were, personal impact factor. So it's very important. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I think we should thank Olaf and the other speakers. And this is just a reminder that at 2 o'clock we have two great closing keynotes. So I assume there are many people here using Spotify, so the analytics of Spotify. And also Alexander Rinoy-Kahn will give a talk. And for many years, he was considered to be the most influential person in the Netherlands. So please come to these keynotes. Thank you very much.
Thank you.